Hello friends and good morning. Welcome to the new lesson on watercolor painting. The story. We have a small garden here, and in the garden we have put some bird feeders. During the daytime, we find variety of birds, including the sparrows mainly. We do have pigeons and we have parrots as well. So a thought came to my mind, why not paint parrots? So today's topic is parrots. So let's get going. Usual materials, 300 GSM, rough paper. Paper is the most important, so please don't economize in that. 300 GSM rough paper is necessary. Brand slightly here and there is okay. So try to paint on the rough paper. Four varieties of brushes, as I've been telling you, 3/4 inch or 1 inch flat, then 10 inch, 10 number, 6 number and 2 number brush. So I use Cotton Students Grade paints, so that is good enough. So let's get going. Best of luck to me as well as you. Okay, let's begin. So these are the materials which I'll be using. 3-4 brushes, about 10, 6 and 2 number, as well as a flat brush, or one can use a large size brush, which I'm going to try and demonstrate to you. Actually, you can use a large size flat brush as well. Now the first activity obviously starts with the sketching. Sketching here is slightly more intricate, in the sense there are two parrots instead of one. So what I suggest to you is for those people who are beginners, you can take up only one parrot in front, the one in front, and instead of the parrot at the back, you can have that particular background which is anyway there, and just extend that particular background, a green background, and so that it will become easier. So in this particular picture, I see there are quite a few branches moving around here and there. So I'm going to actually reduce the number of branches. So many branches are not really required, they are also disturbing. So you have to remember one thing, and I think repeat it quite a few times, is that here you are the managing director. You are the managing director for this particular painting, so he is a self-proclaimed king of the painting, right? So it's your world, you take those decisions, what needs to be done, tonal values here and there, variation, and some changes in the background, or adding or reducing the branches, all those things, whatever you want to do. So here I'm trying to sort of accommodate. Now we are actually finished the sketching stage, so starting with the painting stage. So I've accommodated even the palette now. So what I'm trying to do is I'm applying water around the parrots so as to have a diffused background. Why diffused? Because that way your focus will be on parrots, and your eyes will not keep on moving from parrots to a couple of leaves around and couple of fruits or flowers around and all that. So that's the reason we are going to have the blur background. See, what I'm doing is I have taken sap green and lemon yellow mixture, and I'm trying to sort of create those leaves with the full intention, full knowledge that these leaves which are right now seen by you will not remain as it is, they'll get refused, because we are working wet on wet. That is, the wet surface which we had, the surface of the paper which we had wetted, is still wet, and I'm trying to have brush strokes on those, so they are going to have a diffused effect. If you will see the original photograph, there is a top green part, almost one third of the painting. Then there are blue patches, that is the patches of the sky which are seen, and very important, because the bottom parrot, its beak, if it is against a darker, you know, green, then it will not be seen very clearly. So I'm going to actually have almost white surface there in front of the beak, you understand? So that the contrast of that red and white will be really prominent. Right, so I'm moving on to the parrots now. Now here again, we have to move. You, by now you must have become an expert. From light to dark, watercolor means always light to dark. So you have to find out the lightest tonal value of that particular green and the entire surface of both the parrots. Actually, you can merge both those parrots also, excepting for the branches you need to leave some space, and for the beaks, beaks are red. Now even if it is lighter green tone, we should not allow that light green to enter the beak part, because the beaks are going to be brilliantly red, beautiful red, and a slightest of green tinge also will pollute it. So don't allow that, leave the entire white surface as it is. Now I am painting around that beak of the top parrot, and what I am now doing is I am switching over the colors to Viridian green. Now Viridian green can very easily be prepared also by using Persian blue and Gumbos yellow. So, or any blue and yellow if you take in and keep on varying the quantities, I think slightly more bluish, then it becomes Viridian green. And I am blending after having put first, remember to blend, that should become part of you. Even in dream, if you put a brush stroke of watercolor, the next stroke or after a few strokes maybe, it should be a clean brush, maybe wiped on that particular cloth so that excess water is drained off, to be moved around the earlier brush stroke to blend it smoothly so that it doesn't form the edge. And it has to be done little fast before the watercolor dries off. I am luckily operating in the climate which is very humid. Humidity is almost 95-96% here today. So it will not dry very fast. So I can take little comfort and have little more time. But especially in places which are dry, as well as if it is afternoon time, then it's have a multiplying effect of dryness. So there you have to be careful. Maybe at times it could be advisable to spray, you know, the water on the painting. I will show you in some of my next paintings. It has to be from a distance so that a fine spray lies on the paper. It should not be very close, otherwise it will disturb the painted surface. I've increased the value, if you see, of the bottom parrot by having more color and less water, something like 50-50, and blended it on the left hand side so that it nicely forms a beautiful color from dark to light, and it also gives a curved effect. As I showed, I think I had shown you during the value session, if any plain round surface has to be converted into sphere, what do? You have a darker shade on one end and then keep on making it lighter so that it takes a curve. That's what the stomach of the parrot, how the stomach of the parrot was made. Now here, if you will see, the bottom parrot head is now really you are able to make out and separate out. Earlier it was a plain light sap green, and both the parrots we had merged together, but with the darker shade of the top parrot, now the head part of the bottom parrot has been separated. Now that is how you need to separate out various objects in watercolor, and they should not be done by using lines. In the childhood, I remember I always like to, you know, immediately have the lines around the parrot so that it can be separate. Now, earlier painting which we had done, which was line and color, so which was that particular technique. It should not be repeated in all the paintings. In fact, it should not be repeated in any painting at all. There should not be any lines. In the nature, there are no lines, right? So here, I know the wing of the bottom parrot is, you know, emerging out with the help of a higher tonal value at the bottom as well as at the top. Now here, if you will see the wing, has you know, beautiful shadow at the bottom, and that is what is separating out that wing, so which I will be painting in a short while from now. Right now we are going ahead with the left wing of the parrot, and I'm taking care to leave the branch, and there are one or two fruits, I think, like flowers, so I'm leaving those whites as it is, and I'm painting around those flowers. Now look at the dark color which I have taken. This color has been prepared by using now olive green. Olive green is a dark shade of green, and little bit of pinace gray one can add, so, or ultramarine blue. So any of these colors you can try to make a deeper tone. That is what the photograph is telling you about. Similarly, the top parrot also has darker tonal value. See, the sun is falling on these parrots from 10 o'clock direction. 10 o'clock direction, this is how actually the military people talk about the directions. It becomes very easy to, you know, rather than talking about left side and the top side, top left, there is a sun. Rather than that, I will say 10 o'clock. So because of that, the shadows have formed on the right hand side of both these wings of the bottom parrot. So these shadows are actually accentuating, they are making the parrot more beautiful. So paint those with a clean single stroke. No, don't have multiple strokes, so that it becomes a clean edge. Drying at times is required, especially as I told you, because of the humid situation here, it is not drying and it will take a lot of time. Our painting will become quite lengthy. So now here I have stopped painting for a minute or so. The reason is I wanted to explain to you now how we are going to move ahead. Now red color and green color, if you remember, in the colors we had seen they are complementary colors. Complementary colors, if they are brought together in the picture becomes more attractive. So it's a green parrot, green background, and beautiful red two beaks. So they need to be painted very carefully, and they will add a sudden jump up into the beauty of this painting. So I'll be painting those, and those beaks also have actually three shades. If you will see, it's a crimson red plain color you can give, then lift up some color from the top side of the beak so that, so as to make it lighter, and on the edges of the beak you can add a darker shade by adding burnt umber, so that the beak becomes darker on the edges. That also will separate the beak with respect to the background, green, light green smudged background which we have, and it will accentuate, it will give add to the beauty of the parrot. See how beautiful these parrots are looking. Now these twigs and branches is very simple. You can add the yellow ochre, and you can add a little bit of burnt umber, and move them around, you know, plain strokes. So on the branches, and maybe some lower side of the branches, you can give a darker brown color, which is raw umber, so that the branches of the trees will look beautiful. Okay, now here I had painted, I think, the flowers, which are yellow colored. You can have background of those flowers, or they're very small in size, but yellow colored flowers need to be completed. Here I think we are coming to the end of the painting. Okay, here we come to the end of another learning episode. I hope you are enjoying all these learning experiences and also enjoying the process. Let me know in your comments section in case you want any course correction, so that I can accordingly improvise upon my presentation styles. And don't forget to like and subscribe in case you have not done so, because after retirement you will agree there are less opportunities for encouragement. So do encourage, and it will help me to work harder. Thank you and good day to you. Bye.